Welcome back once again to the Parkinson's Disease Education Podcast. In this episode, we're going to be covering atypical Parkinsonism versus Parkinson's disease. If you're not familiar with this concept, there are some conditions that mimic Parkinson's disease, but are not, in fact, Parkinson's disease. In fact, some of them are quite different than Parkinson's, although the physical limitations and some of the symptoms manifest very similarly to Parkinson's disease. But you should know the difference because often people tend to be misdiagnosed with Parkinson's disease when in fact they may have other conditions that don't respond to the typical treatments associated with PD. Stay tuned for this episode. I think you'll learn a lot. Bear with me if this is a little bit longer, but there's a lot to cover and I want to cover it with you. So I hope to see you on the other side of the intro. 3, 2, 1, and let's go. Welcome to the Parkinson's Disease Education Show, where we demystify the disease and empower you as the person with Parkinson's disease to reach your true potential. The content contained on this show is for informational purposes only and is not meant to be a replacement for information or advice that you receive from your in-person medical or therapy professionals. If you haven't already, I hope you'll consider subscribing, and for an even more personalized experience, please ask us about our memberships. Now, without further ado, let's start the show. As you may have guessed, there's quite a bit to unpack with the topic of atypical Parkinsonism compared to Parkinson's disease. Another term for atypical Parkinsonism is Parkinson's plus. And these are conditions that, as I mentioned in the intro, are similar to Parkinson's disease in some ways, in other ways quite different, but they may appear to be similar or the same on the outside. So for somebody who's not as well trained, or even for a physician who's trying to diagnose you with a condition, some of the symptoms may appear to be Parkinson's, but they aren't Parkinson's. And that's why it's referred to as a Parkinsonism, because essentially all these conditions we're going to be talking about are Parkinson's lookalikes, if you will. Diagnostic criteria for these other conditions that kind of seem like Parkinson's disease are varied, because while response to levodopa is telling, there are other tests that are more specific that may be needed to kind of see what you're dealing with. We'll talk a little bit in more detail about that as we go along, because there are some different tests that may help to rule in or rule out some of these conditions, and they differ between some of these. Primarily, we're going to be focused on four types of Parkinson's plus or atypical Parkinsonism, and those are dementia with Lewy bodies, multiple system atrophy, corticobasal degeneration, and progressive supranuclear palsy. While there are some other subtypes we might discuss, I want to leave it to those primary four just because some of the other conditions are not quite as common, but I may mention them in passing as well without going into as much detail. First, let's talk about Lewy body dementia or dementia with Lewy bodies. In a previous episode, I covered the comparisons between dementia with Lewy bodies and Parkinson's disease dementia, and you can find that up here. However, for the purposes of this episode, I want to talk about the hallmarks of Lewy body dementia compared to Parkinson's disease and how that might be distinguished from a primary Lewy body dementia diagnosis and Parkinson's disease diagnosis. So the primary things you see with dementia with Lewy bodies are a progressive short-term memory loss and confusion, as well as changes in attention and alertness. Those changes in cognition tend to happen early, before any physical limitations might show up. Typically, the progression of LBD is quite rapid, with mortality at times within 3 to 5 years of diagnosis. There are, of course, exceptions to that, so don't think of that as the rule of the situation. Another hallmark of Lewy body dementia is visual hallucinations. These are manifestations of shadowy figures in the corner of your eye, or in some cases, as with a patient of mine, seeing an entire football team practicing in front of them in their living room. While with Parkinsonian conditions, other types of hallucinations can occur, such as smells that don't exist and so forth, the visual hallucinations are primary with Lewy body dementia. In addition to that, you can also have issues of delusions where the person believes things to be true that aren't true. And that also can lead to things like paranoia, where you're thinking everybody's out to get you, even the people that are the closest to you that love you the most. Lewy body dementia is also quite commonly preceded by REM sleep behavioral disorder and other sleep disturbances but REM sleep behavioral disorder is very commonly linked with Lewy body dementia. As I mentioned previously, Parkinsonian-like symptoms tend to show up a little bit later with Lewy body dementia. So those cognitive symptoms will show up first, and then typically following that, you'll have symptoms like rigidity, short shuffling steps, stooped posture, and similar issues. We've talked about this before, but just before moving on, I wanted to mention Lewy bodies are formed from alpha-synuclein aggregates. Alpha-synuclein is an abnormal protein that is found in persons with Parkinson's disease, and it's found in large clumps throughout the brain and in other nerve tissues. So even though Lewy bodies can be found in persons with Parkinson's disease later in the diagnosis or as the person may progress along with Parkinson's, they're typically not found early in the diagnosis to the point where you would diagnose somebody with something like Lewy body dementia. In Lewy body dementia, it's very likely those Lewy bodies have been there for a while before symptoms have started. Next, we have multiple system atrophy. As the name implies, multiple system atrophy affects more than just the basal ganglia. The basal ganglia are affected by multiple system atrophy, which leads to the movement disorders that you find with MSA. However, MSA also affects other parts of the central nervous system, and that's why it's really important to understand that for looking at the symptoms we're going to talk about. Because of the pathology of multiple system atrophy, you tend to find issues with the central nervous system, primarily the autonomic nervous system. So you can have issues like dizziness or sudden drops in blood pressure, orthostatic hypotension. That's a very common symptom of MSA. You can have sexual dysfunction, particularly in males, where you have erectile dysfunction early in the diagnosis. You can also have loss of bladder control, possibly bowel control as well. Now, multiple system atrophy, unlike Lewy body dementia, will tend to show up as a Parkinson's-like limitations on the outside. So you'll have balance and fall problems, posture issues, slow movements, small movements, rigid trunk and limbs, things like that. But some of these other hallmarks of MSA will show up potentially even earlier in some cases. So that blood pressure dropping, problems with bowel and bladder control, and ED for males, those things may show up before diagnosis even happens, or before the Parkinson's-like symptoms show up as well, but they may also coincide. It's hard to diagnose a lot of these conditions just simply when the symptoms show up. That's why more scans are needed. So something we'll talk about further on is diagnostic criteria and distinguishing that with other conditions, but we'll talk about symptoms first and we'll go into that after we talk about these conditions. Next one we want to talk about is progressive supranuclear palsy. This is a very Parkinsonian-like disorder with similar movement disorders as Parkinson's, as we mentioned before. But something distinct with PSP is you tend to have eye movement involvement. For example, you can have limited upward or downward eye movements. In some cases, you may have an upward or downward gaze that's more or less fixed, but eye movement all around can be slowed down greatly. Generally, eye movements aren't very affected by Parkinson's disease. Progressive supranuclear palsy tends to show up as very early progression of balance and fall issues. A lot of those physical limitations will happen really quickly. Whereas with Parkinson's disease, you can really slow down a lot of those negative symptoms by physical activity and exercise and also medication. Also, early and more severe issues with thinking and behavioral changes can occur in PSP compared to Parkinson's disease. The fourth condition is corticobasal degeneration. Corticobasal degeneration is really distinct in terms of muscle tightness and jerking. You can have also abnormal hand and feet postures with increased dystonia. That's a little bit more distinct with CBD compared to other conditions. Also poor coordination. Now, Parkinson's disease can affect coordination in terms of being able to walk and chew gum at the same time, so to speak. For example, you may have difficulty with reciprocal movements like swinging the arm forward and backward while rocking forward and backward. You know, having trouble like, okay, which arm goes with which leg, and it might just look awkward and you have trouble getting started with that movement, but ultimately you can make it happen if you concentrate on it long enough. But with CBD, you can actually have coordination issues like not being able to meet your two fingers in the middle or not being able to touch your finger to your nose. With Parkinson's disease, you might have slower ability to make those movements, but you can still have the accuracy. But with CBD, you may have issues with actually being able to really accurately do that motion any longer. I hope that illustrated the example well enough, but I'm sure I'll hear about it in the comments if it didn't. Now, brief, as I promised before, I'm only going to mention these other conditions in passing, maybe to look up some more information on your own. But just so you know, there are some other secondary forms of Parkinsonism or acquired Parkinsonism that I want to mention briefly in this episode, and just so you are aware of them. These aren't all together very common, but they are other presentations of Parkinsonism that you may find out there. So one of these is drug-induced Parkinsonism, where a medication a person is taking is actually resulting in Parkinson's-like symptoms. Typically, cessation of that medication will eliminate the Parkinsonian-like symptoms. So it's not always a permanent condition. However, recreational drug abuse can result in permanent Parkinsonism in some cases. Another type is vascular Parkinsonism. This is essentially where blood clots or mini strokes in the brain are resulting in Parkinson's-like symptoms because it's affecting the areas of the brain that Parkinson's, for example, lives in, like the basal ganglia. And also, very briefly, there's other secondary forms of Parkinsonism that you may hear about out there that you should be aware of but aren't altogether common, as I mentioned before. So there's metabolic diseases such as Wilson's disease, endocrine problems like hypothyroidism, heavy metal poisoning, infectious diseases such as Whipple's, normal pressure hydrocephalus, where you have an abnormal amount of cerebrospinal fluid in the ventricles of the brain, certain toxins, as well as repetitive head trauma can all result in secondary forms of Parkinsonism. They aren't Parkinson's disease, so with any of the ones we've mentioned, including the earlier ones where we talked about the atypical forms of Parkinsonism, levodopa may or may not result in any improvement in symptoms. So there may be other medications that make a difference, but that's going to depend on the individual case and the condition and pathologies involved. So in terms of diagnosis, as I mentioned before, levodopa may or may not be a good diagnostic criteria because some atypical forms of Parkinsonism may respond a little bit to the increase in dopamine, but some may not respond at all. To get a proper diagnosis, it's important and paramount to have somebody who really dives into this every day, like a movement disorder specialist neurologist, but also imaging and other tests can help. Biomarker tests is really what I mean by other tests. For example, with Parkinson's disease, we know that Parkinson's is a synucleinopathy. So alpha-synuclein is a positive biomarker for Parkinson's disease in many cases. So there are skin biopsy tests for alpha-synuclein. There's also, I believe, a cerebrospinal fluid test or a spinal tap version of that now that's a relatively new test. Biomarker tests for something like alpha-synuclein are very valuable. Now, with other conditions like with progressive supranuclear palsy, MSA, and corticobasal degeneration, those tend to be what we call tauopathies. Those tend to have a prevalence of the biomarker of tau protein, which is, again, similar to the alpha-synuclein. You have abnormal amounts of tau protein aggregating in these other conditions that we mentioned. They just might be found in other parts of the brain as they aggregate. MRI is also a common diagnostic tool to see if there's changes in the cortex of the brain or in specific areas of the brain, and that's typically where you will find the imaging that shows Lewy bodies or things like beta amyloid plaques like in Alzheimer's disease. Finally, the DAT scan could also help to rule Parkinson's in or out, although, again, the DAT scan may be a positive test for conditions like Parkinson's disease in more than one condition. So it's hard to, even then, to always narrow down Parkinson's disease versus something like Lewy body dementia. You may have dopamine transporter molecule issues, which is the DAT scan will show a positive test if there's less dopamine uptake happening in the brain. That can happen in other conditions besides Parkinson's disease. So unlike the One Ring in Tolkien's Lord of the Rings, one test is not going to rule them all. That's probably going to be enough to talk about atypical Parkinsonism compared to Parkinson's disease. Well, I think that's going to be a wrap for atypical Parkinsonism versus Parkinson's disease. What did you think? I hope this was interesting to you. And let me know in the comments if you've experienced a misdiagnosis of Parkinson's when you, in fact, had one of these other conditions. And if so, how are you getting along in your daily life? Something I neglected to mention is that exercise, therapy, and so forth can be greatly helpful for all the conditions that we talked about even though there's no cure-all, it will be something that's very beneficial to help prevent negative changes, more rapid progression, even potentially to help you to get back to things you weren't able to do before. I've worked personally with patients that have multiple system atrophy and progressive supranuclear palsy, and they have made very positive changes with therapies like LSVT-BIG, for example. Although lifespans may be shorter with conditions like MSA and CBD, for example, there is a lot that can be said about these about therapy for helping these people have a better quality of life and to prevent worsening symptoms from happening as quickly as they might without any intervention. Again, thank you for being here. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Please be sure to like this video, subscribe if you haven't already. Up to 80% of our viewers on YouTube aren't subscribed yet. It doesn't cost you a dime, so what are you waiting for? Please subscribe and support the channel in that way. If you're feeling like you want a little bit of extra attention and more personalized help, please consider our memberships or booking a consulting call with me. I'd love to help you. Finally, please be sure to visit the links to our channel sponsors in the description below. Thanks. I'll see you in the next episode. Be empowered.